this is what it used to be 20 odd years ago, as you well know. That's just an observation. Secondly, a lot of the stuff in how you're going to get there, it seems to me, from my previous experiences, that it's not going back to transitional arrangements between children who are experiencing change. So, for example, getting ready for school, moving between primary and secondary, and then moving on to the workforce and employment. I've heard this for so long, as you know, I was involved in planning and transitions in a previous life, but I still can't get my head around how, for example, schools in transitions between primary and secondary, quite often at the time when I was involved, you find secondary schools going, "We didn't know this about child A, we didn't know this about child B." It's almost like there's no smooth transition between those arrangements. Is there anything solid in place to address that?
One thing that I think is happening that will promote that, and we do need to make the plans, and as I say, this is still work in progress, the plans are really specific and measurable. But one thing that started in Wirral in September of last year was that schools, primary and secondary schools, have clustered on a constituency footprint. So there are three clusters, I think south and west are just one cluster, and then there's Wallasey. And that's around school-to-school support in respect of school improvement and standards. So we've got the situation now where some primary schools, it's all going to secondary schools, assessing the standard of their teaching and where the gaps are in children attaining. And what we're finding, it's still early days, but there's a much more open and collegiate approach. And traditionally, primary schools and secondary schools are in two, as you quite rightly said, Mark, they're in separate camps. And what's happening now is we've got one school commissioner whose background is a primary head teacher. She is pushing them to work collegiately and think of children across a whole gender. So there's much more likelihood and an appetite for thinking about that transition than I think we've ever had.
Thanks, Julia. My only worry about all of this is working with schools is the academy status school in my ward, because I've got two cases in my ward, and both of which I think come under the triple families criteria, and it's how we go about working with the academy, knowing that we don't have the main level authority control. So do you have anything in mind for that?
Thank you. I think the approach that we've taken to academies, we do have a very different kind of legal and running status than maintained schools, is that both Sue and myself and officers in the local authority take the role that we're here to be champions for children. And that gives us an in by force of kind of the relationships that into the schools regardless of their status. There have been occasions where schools have done things, I can think of one secondary school where in one term about six youngsters were permanently excluded, where we've actually said we do not think this is acceptable in any shape or form. So I think Michael Wilshaw said you've got to really use the authority that you've got, the authorities, in terms of schools within your patch. So in that instance, that school was, I issued them a warning notice and referred to the Education Funding Agency and required them all to come and see me, senior staff, to explain why they'd excluded six children. And they did. And they brought lots of people with, you know, they were sitting in a line outside quite nervous, feeling they got to come pick out for themselves. So there are still opportunities and criteria that you can use to hold schools to account. We had a situation with another school just before Christmas where we reported them to the Education Funding Agency because they were refusing to accept a looked after child into the school through the admissions process. So raise the issues, yeah, and it's really important. We'll do our best to address them, regardless of the status.
Thank you.
be more successful. We do monitor turnover. What would be really good, I'm thinking as you talk, it would be much better if we had another indicator that was about young people talking to us and telling us their experiences, routine, that being the changes in social work. But we do monitor that turnover on a monthly basis. The position is better since we introduced new social work pay. So we now have what's called a professional capability framework that was implemented in January of last year, which means that social workers can progress from being a newly qualified worker to a mainstream social worker to an experienced social worker. And there's required training to pass the bar to move from one level to another. But the financing and the pay for the experienced social worker is now much more comparable to other local authorities. What we are doing at the moment is we've got some additional capacity or identified someone within human resources who can act as an engine room and follow the process from advert right through to the person starting and switching their computer on, so that we can try and speed up the time it takes from advert to somebody actually starting in the authority. But during the last year, we've had far too much turnover still, and it's something we need to monitor extremely. There's a new campaign that came out a few months ago, and we've got a number of adolescent foster carers who are attempting to encourage people to move into fostering. We know that there's little videos on the council website. We know the best way of securing additional foster carers is through word of mouth. And I think it's right to say that the majority of our foster carers are still in the Wallasey and Birkenhead area, and we need to move out across, you know, make sure that we get into churches and different communities across the whole group. In terms of special guardians, I think you're probably talking about connected carers in particular, and I just, I mean, that's not about capacity, but just linking back to the point you made earlier, I continue on with further vigour, take forward the points you made about connected carers and their calibre and capacity to save your parent and children.
Okay, are we done with that? Thank you very much, Julia. I think that we know that presentation. And the next item is Fiona Johnson, yeah, and you're going to talk to us about child poverty and improving life chances. Just before we move on, can I just say, it really makes this school readiness piece of work that we're going to do all the more pertinent, and we are very much going up with the dimension of that panel when we're going to get that started before we do this. But thank you for being there.
Thank you, Chair. This presentation really links very closely with the juniors, so it's great to be able to do them side by side, if you like. The work that I want to stay on is the work of the what is the child poverty working group? We named ourselves Improving Life Chances group to reflect feedback we had from local people that said we don't like being described as poor, and to give a much more positive approach to it, which said, yeah, actually this is about what we want to achieve for people, and we're going to bring a much more as I say, positive and positive to develop our improving life chances. This is really the fourth of the four pledges in the rural plan that are linked to children. But I think the important thing to point to make here, thanks for coming, is that it connects to a lot of the other pledges too. It connects to pledges that link to employment. It connects to all the pledges around adults, and engagement, and learning. It connects very much to the environment, the housing, where people live, and all of those different things are really critical to the aspects of this particular strategy. So I just wanted to give you an update on where the group has got to in developing a strategy and the next steps. So just to remind you, the vision was very much around trying to reduce the